Coming up soon, I'm going to be adding a video on using the Raspberry Pi and Arduino together. However, I realise that many of my followers may not have actually used an Arduino, so in this video I'm going to look at the basics. If you're already familiar with the Arduino, the IDE and the C++ programming language, then hopefully the next video will be of more interest as it will look at the serial programming on both the Arduino and the Raspberry Pi. Here is a photo of two particular Arduino models. To give you an idea of size, these are alongside a half plus breadboard. The larger Arduino on the left is an UNO. In this video I'll actually be using a Leonardo, which is the same size board as the UNO. The Leonardo has a micro USB socket rather than the standard USB socket, but otherwise, as far as this video is concerned, they are interchangeable. The Arduino on the right is a Maker Wi-Fi 1010, which is the smaller format, and this particular model has built-in Wi-Fi. Also note that the larger format boards are usually 5-volt logic input and output, whereas the Maker series are normally 3.3-volt. Also note that the Maker boards have long pins and can be connected to a breadboard. Before we get ahead of ourselves, what exactly is an Arduino? Arduino is actually the name of one particular manufacturer and their boards, which are based around microcontrollers. These are small computers, but not computers that you can connect up to a mouse and keyboard. These have much less functionality and will run your own code directly on the processor. They can be used when you want an electronic circuit that needs to make a decision and gives you much more flexibility compared to a fixed function electronic components. For example, if you want a light to come on when it's dark, then that's a simple circuit you can make with a light dependent resistor, a transistor and a few other components. You can also make it adjustable with a variable resistor. But what if your outdoor light keeps going off whenever a car drove past? With a microprocessor, such as an Arduino, then you could add additional criteria, like only turning lights off after it's been bright for a certain period of time. Or you could add another sensor to maybe light an area differently if there's a risk of rain, or when this particular door is opened. This is achieved by adding some program code that can make decisions based on the specific inputs, which change the relevant outputs. You may still need additional electronics, perhaps an external transistor to switch a bright LED, but the decision-making process and the logic decisions are all handled by the microcontroller. The Arduino can perform some complex digital logic operations. This photo shows it being used to drive some 7-segment LED displays, as shown in a video I created on digital electronics. In this video, I'm going to make a more basic circuit based around the idea of an automatic nightlight that I mentioned earlier. This is the circuit as shown how it will be created on a breadboard. I'm not going to use the exact same pin positions. As long as they're on the same column for the central part of the diagram, or in the case of the power lines, as long as they're on the same row, then they're still connected together. So here I've got my Arduino mounted with a breadboard onto this base, which I've created. Just helps to keep the two together. If you want to see this, there's links in the description if you want to print your own, because they're 3D printable. So what I'm going to do is create the circuit. There's the LDR, light dependent resistor, a 1 kilo ohm resistor to create a potential divider so that we can get the analog voltage. And then we've got a white LED with a 330 ohm resistor. Yeah. And then some leads to wire it up with as well. First, just take the power supply, the 5-volt supply, because the analog input allows up to 5 volts. And great voltage divider using the LDR and the LED, which is going to form my input to analog A0. This wire will reach. Then needs the positive voltage as well connecting there. LED, the longer lead is usually the positive, the anode, so put that in there. The positive end there. The resistor connecting down to ground. And then connecting the other end to digital pin 2. So it's 012. 01 is the transmit, receive and transmit for serial communications. So we'll avoid those and just taking the next port along. That's the circuit wired up. This diagram shows the circuit as a schematic diagram, which I think helps to make it easier to understand. You can see the input on the left, which is to analog input A0, and the output goes from pin 2. It's labelled as SDA on the diagram, but that's an alternative function and it's not how we're using it here. In this case, it's just been used as digital output 2 and is driving an LED. To program the Arduino, then that's easiest done using the Arduino IDE or Integrated Development Environment. This allows you to create the code on a computer, compile it to the binary code that the Arduino understands, and then upload it to the Arduino. Here I'm going to install the Arduino IDE on a Raspberry Pi 4. To install is as simple as entering apt install Arduino from a command prompt. If you want to do this on another operating system, then you can download the IDE from the Arduino website at arduino.cc. I'm going to start by launching the Arduino IDE and it starts with a blank file. I'm going to save that first and give it a name. Now there's a few rules on this. You can't have spaces, it can't begin with a number, and it can't have hyphens, I think, and they will all get converted into underscores, the spaces, if you put a space in. I'll just call this light example one. If I, as habit, I've put hyphens in, I'm pretty sure they're going to get converted to underscores. Yeah, so what it's done, it's just changed those to underscores. So as far as programming is concerned, before I get into the program, I need to find my device first. Often you'll only have the one here. You can ignore the one that says zero. That's for direct communications that I've been doing, which will be on a future video. It's usually TTY ACM0. If it disconnects and reconnects, it sometimes comes back in as M1. And if you've got some of the older boards, that might say USB0 as well. So it's usually just the one option. Choose the board that you're using. And in this case, I've got Leonardo. You may be using a UNO. And that's all we need to do at this stage. So the programming language we'll use here is based on C++. If you're not familiar with C++, then it's quite a useful language to learn. But it has a lot of additional syntax, which you might be not used to if you've used a language such as Python before. So it just needs a little bit more of that, and it can be a little bit more fussy. But it doesn't care about spacing, unlike Python. So there's pros and cons to both. We're going to define some variables first. In C++, you need to specify what they'll be. So I'm going to call these integers. I'm just going to use these as normal variables rather than define these as constants. And I'm going to call this the analog pin, which is the pin I'm going to use for the analog input. Use A0 for analog 0. And for the digital pin, which is going to be our digital output, you just use the number of the pin. So I'm going to use 2. 0 and 1 are often used for serial communication, so best to avoid those, just taking the next pin along, which is 2. I'm going to create a function. When you create a function in C or C++, you need to put what its return value is going to be, and void means it's not going to return anything. And you have to create the setup function. So this is a default function that will always run. And see the curly braces are used to define the function. And the only thing we need to set up is we need to set the digital pin as an output. The analog pin is always an input because it's just an analog input, but the digital pin does need to be defined. And you just say pin mode, digital pin number, which we use the variable, and use output all in capitals. And you must terminate every line with a semicolon. That's it for the setup. The next function I'm going to create another void. These are the standard functions that will just be called by the bootloader. You don't need to call these from anywhere. So this one is called the loop, and this will be run pretty much constantly. So it's just constantly going to be running this with the code that you put in here will be running. I'm going to start with a local variable called analog value, just a variable that we can store the input from the analog into, and then we'll put that value in. And we use the analog read. It's all fairly straightforward if you're used to the syntax of this. It's not too dissimilar from syntaxes such as JavaScript use and Java use as well, although this is more fussy about that than JavaScript in particular. The analog read function will give you a value back between 0 and 1023, which is based on the voltage compared to the 5 volt power supply. So the higher the voltage, the higher the value. With the potential divider we've got with the LDR and the resistor, then we'll get a smaller range. When it's very dark, you get a value of in the low tens, and very light then in the value of a few hundreds. And I've just worked that out by actually just varying the light, and I've been monitoring the value on that pin. So for this, I'm going to just set the value as 200. If it's below 200, then it's classed as dark and we'll turn the LED on. If it's above 200, then it's going to be classed as light and we'll turn the LED off. And do that using an if statement. So we're just going to check if the analog value is less than 200, then we'll run this block of text, which will be to use digital write to set the digital pin to a value of high, which will turn the LED on. Else, we'll do a digital write, set the digital pin to low, and turn the LED off. So I've sort of picked this value of 200 just because of some very basic testing I've done. The great things about this is that you can just change that value if you find that you want to increase the amount of brightness or decrease the amount of brightness. Just try a different value until you get what you want. And one of the things about this is just a case of pushing the new code to it, to the Arduino. I'm going to add a delay in here, which is just going to mean that there's going to be a while before it runs the next loop, because if not, it'll just constantly run this loop and the values will change instantly. Isn't really a problem, but if I add this delay here, you'll see what's actually happening a bit better, because there'll be a delay. It's measured in milliseconds, so not seconds like you might have used in some languages. So that's 1,000 milliseconds, that's 1 second between each run. Once we've done that, got two buttons here. I'll just save it first. There's two icons, buttons here that you can use. The first one will just verify the code. It will compile it but not send it to the Arduino. And the second one will do the same, compile the code, but then also push it to the Arduino. So normally I just go straight to the second one, but you can do them as two steps if you prefer. So you see, it tells you the size of the binary it created, and it pushes that to the Arduino, and it says done uploading. Once the Arduino has received that, then it resets itself and starts running the code. And you should just get this simple message to say it's all done and done uploading. If you've got any errors in your code, I'll just show you an example. If I forgot to put the semicolon on the end of there, and then tried to verify or upload, get this orange error message, error compiling, tells you the error in the function loop. I had an error, expected a semicolon before the closing brace. It says it's on line 2, character 1, so line 22, character 1. And this is line 22, you can see the line numbering at the very bottom. And what it actually means though is that it expected it before this, so the actual error is on line 21, so that's where we need to fix it. And again, you can just click upload, it'll recompile it and push it, and it just uploads that to the Arduino. And one of the great things is about the Arduino is you can just change whatever you need in here whenever you need, and just keep pushing an update. And you can add more complicated logic in this, or you could change it to suit your needs, basically. Here you can see the code working. Starting with the lighting dimmed, the LED is on. But when the brightness of the lighting is increased, the LED goes off. When it gets darker, then the LED comes back on. Here you can see a problem if the light in the room is turned down just to the point of turning off. And here the LED flashes on and off as the threshold is reached. I've dropped the time delay just to make it easy to see. This can be tricky to fix in a physical circuit, but on the Arduino it's quite easy because it can be fixed in code. You could put code to set the turn on and the turn off thresholds to be different light levels, or add in other sensors or timing to improve the way that the circuit reacts. This can all be done just by updating the code and then pushing that to the Arduino. There is no need to touch the electronics. This is similar to how firmware upgrades can be performed on other hardware devices you may have in the home. This video has only covered the basics of what could be achieved with the Arduino. There is lots of documentation on the web, including the official website, arduino.cc, and some examples on my own Arduino playlist on YouTube. In the next video, I'll be demonstrating how you can use a Raspberry Pi and Arduino together, so please subscribe to my channel and hit the notification bell to be notified when that video is available. Thanks for watching.